السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him for everything He has bestowed upon us. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, all his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them all and to grant them all goodness and ease, and us as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us every form of goodness and ease in this world as well as the next. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, yesterday we made mention of a very interesting narration that I had said was a weak narration, if you recall. And I did say that the reason why I made mention of it was because of the lesson that we wanted to derive from it. This narration regarding verse number 75 of Surah At-Tawbah is narrated by Al-Wahidi in his book Asbab al-Nuzul, as well as As-Suyuti in a similar book, Al-Tabarani, Al-Bayhaqi, Al-Hakim, Hadith of Abu Umamah radiyallahu anhu. However, there is a very interesting explanation, and that is something that each one of us needs to take notice of. We all know that the Battle of Badr took place. That was the most decisive battle in the history of Islam. It was the battle whereby, against all odds, the Muslimin won. There were only approximately 313 Muslims and perhaps 1,000 plus from amongst the Kuffar. The Muslimin were not even armed properly. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted something to occur, and that was the victory at that particular time with the small number. And one of those who took part in this particular battle was a man known as Tha'labah ibn Hatib al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, the man whom some of those have made mention of in the narration. Now we have one problem, and the problem is, if you go back to the Battle of Badr and you take a look at it, you will find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam later on made mention of the virtue of the people who participated in the Battle of Badr, and he said, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ اطَّلَعَ عَلَى أَهْلِ بَدْرِ فَقَالَ اعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ فَإِنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكُمْ. He says, what do you know? Perhaps Allah has looked at the hearts of those who participated in the Battle of Badr, and He told them, from today, you can do as you please. I am happy with you. Subhanallah. Do as you please. Amazing. So if we were to look at this, we would realize that those who participated in the Battle of Badr were known as Badriyin. It was impossible for anyone to blemish their image. They were people who were considered the creme de la creme, if we can say that. They were the top notch, the best of the lot. So it would be wrong for us to actually think for a moment that this man, Tha'labah ibn Hatib al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, who participated in the Battle of Badr, had to be a person who rejected the verse of zakah. So this is where the weakness comes in from. This is why the scholars say it's a weak narration. I'm sure it would have been interesting for us to know, why is it that people say it's a weak narration? So much so that some scholars have gone and said, listen, the naming is actually fabricated. And I think we incline towards that, because it would be wrong for us to take the name of such a great sahabi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand. However, another very interesting point is, it is reported that this man who participated in the Battle of Badr, there was a time when he stopped coming for salah. Do you recall? That also, we would like to say, not him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Similarly, it is reported that when the verses were read to him, he said, no, I need some time. Not him. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. If you notice what we're doing, we're actually making mention why the scholars have said it's weak or fabricated, and we're going back to revisit the status of Tha'labah ibn Hatib al-Ansari radiyallahu anhu. Although I did make mention quite clearly that it was weak, but I decided it is only befitting for us to spend as much time speaking of the merit of this beautiful man. So thereafter, if you take a look at the narration that says he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam crying, saying, "Accept my wealth," it is not befitting for a messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam to reject it. Subhanallah. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he does not reject the tawbah of an individual, why would the messenger who was sent as a means of mercy for mankind and creation at large reject someone who was coming to him with goodness and regret? So this also makes it weak or fabricated. Similarly, when it comes to the issue of the fact that he was from amongst the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Umar al-Faruq radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, it is reported that they too rejected the man's act of worship. That too, we say, there is something wrong with the narration. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and may He open our doors. So one might ask, so what is the narration? Well, there are two or three explanations. One is, there was a group of hypocrites besides Tha'laba ibn Hatib al-Ansari whom that happened with, perhaps. Or secondly, there may have been two or three of them, or there may have been a mix-up in the name. But as for our man, let us all say radiyallahu anhu, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all of us the companionship of those who participated in the battle of Badr on the day of judgment as well as in the akhirah. So this is something extremely interesting. I'd like to still spend another few moments telling you what exactly we derived from the story. Very interesting. When you promise Allah, make sure you fulfill the promise. When you have a little bit and you promise Allah that you're going to give 5%, 10%, that 5%, 10%, when it's 100 rands, it's only 5 rands or 10 rands. The minute it becomes 100,000 rands, it becomes much, much more in terms of figures. Be careful. What you've promised Allah, follow it through. Subhanallah. Similarly, it is not wrong to be wealthy in Islam, but it is wrong for us to become arrogant due to the wealth. Remember this. It's something very interesting. You can have as many garages as you want. You can have as many service stations as you want. Yesterday I made mention of the service stations and one of the brothers came up to me and said, "Did someone tell you about me? I'm the one who has a few service stations." May Allah forgive us, really. May Allah bless you all, wallahi. Service stations or not. May Allah grant us wealth that has barakah. Islam actually acknowledges those who have lots of wealth because they are the ones who will be spending, inshallah, in the right course. So it is a lesson for us to say, look, the more you have, become humble. Become humble. Be down to earth. Whether you have power, position, authority, whatever else it is, wealth, anything, become humble. Don't let that change your attitude negatively. In fact, it should change it positively. Similarly, what we also learn is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed something upon us, we should make use of it in the correct cause. Allah has given you expertise in something. Help the ummah. Serve the ummah with your expertise. You might be a doctor, you might be an accountant, you might be someone. Ask yourself, how did I use my expertise, my field, to serve a little bit of Islam, to serve the deen, to serve humanity, to be able to reach out to the rest of human beings in order to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy. What's also interesting is the regret that we should be feeling whenever we have sinned, whenever we've said something wrong, whenever we've rebuked or whenever we've abused someone, it should be from the heart. We should feel sorry. The remorse should be from deep within. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us acceptance. Brothers and sisters, we move on, still with the battle of Tabuk, still with Surah At-Tawbah. Like I said, this surah has exposed the hypocrites in so many different ways. There were some of the hypocrites, when the battle of Tabuk was announced, it was known as the difficult battle. Why was it the difficult battle? It was just after Ta'if and Hunain, and at the same time it was very, very hot. It was in the middle of the summer, and there was not much that the mu'mineen had. They were gathering wealth, and they had to march a long, long distance, hundreds of kilometers, and go and face the Romans. It was something that was not a joke. So many people began to make excuses, although nobody was excused besides those who were perhaps disabled or completely unable to go. From amongst them were lame excuses, you know, cheap excuses. It reminds me, before I mention this, when we have work to go to, we don't mind how cold or hot it is. When we have a function to go to, we don't mind how cold or hot it is. We don't mind, we'll make a plan, we'll get a lift, we'll do something. When we have salah to go to, suddenly it's too cold, suddenly it's too hot, suddenly it's too long. When we have wudu to make, oh, it's too early in the morning, it's a little bit too cold, the water is not running. When we've got an act of worship, closeness to Allah, we find an excuse. It happens to all of us. Let's apply it in our lives. But when it is something we need to go to the gym, come what may, we are there. One wonders, in the condition of fasting, we are still there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us as steadfast with our salah. My brothers and sisters, it is not wrong, but the point I am raising is, let us understand, if we apply it in one area of our life, to apply it in spirituality and religiousness is even of a greater level in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember this. So this is why those people made an excuse, they did not want to go with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They started telling each other, La tanfiru fil har. Don't go out, it's too hot. Make an excuse that it's extremely hot. Too hot, I can't go. So they started saying it's too hot. Allah exposes them. Verse number 81. Allah replies, responds to them. Guess how Allah replies. What a powerful verse. Mentioned Tafsir al-Tabari, narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, when they were instructed to go out, the battle of Tabuk, some of them said, it's too hot. Allah says, فَرِحَ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ بِمَقْعَدِهِمْ خِلَافَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَكَرِهُوا أَن يُجَاهِدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah says, those who stayed behind, they were happy to stay behind against the Prophet ﷺ and against Allah's instruction. And they were happy not to strive in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what they said? وَقَالُوا لَا تَنْفِرُوا فِي الْحَرُ قُلْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ أَشَدُّ حَرًّا لَوْ كَانُوا يَفْقَهُونَ. They said that, you know what, it's too hot, we cannot go. Allah says, let them know, the fire of hell is even more hot. The fire of hell is hotter, far hotter. The heat is intense, much more intense, if only they had a deep understanding. Don't make cheap excuses when it comes to obeying the instruction of Allah. Get up, forsake your bed. No matter how cold or hot it is, you will make the wudu, you will fulfill your salah, you will adopt the instruction of Allah. If we were to dress in order to go to a party, we are ready to go out and buy clothes that will please the people and that will soothe their eyes, even though they may be haram. But when we are asked to dress in order to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find lame excuses. People are going to think this and that. And some of the young, they now say, how will I get married if I cover myself? May Allah forgive us. Well, if you don't cover yourself, you're going to marry the wrong person. The one who loves those who are uncovered. Once you marry him, you are now his. He looks at the others who are still uncovered. Remember this. So it doesn't stop. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May Allah open our doors and grant us a deep understanding. Like I say, these are reasons of revelation. Interesting to know. Good to apply. The most powerful thing we take home is the lesson from it. The lesson from it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Now we have another very interesting occurrence. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were several hypocrites. We know one of the chiefs, his name was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. I can take the liberty to mention his name because that is confirmed. There is no doubt about this man. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul was the head of the hypocrites known as Ra'sul Munafiqeen. And he caused a lot of harm and damage. Hadith muttafaq alayh, reported by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Another hadith, also in Bukhari, Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Sunan al-Nasa'i, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, reported by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, who is narrating from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He says, when Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, who was the head of the hypocrites, when he died, they called Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to lead the janazah. You see, sometimes a person dies, they select a pious man, they say, look, please, Shaykh, you know, would you mind, there is a request that you lead the janazah, because they perhaps feel that maybe this person will make dua for them. To be honest, the merit was there for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam indeed, but for you and I, so long as that salatul janazah is done, it's okay. Alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Some people think if a pious person officiates your nikah, you won't go through divorce. That is actually fairy tale. So long as the nikah is done correctly, may Allah grant us barakah. So long as we ourselves know why we are marrying and we have taqwa and we know how to fulfill each other's rights, then nothing will go wrong. But even if the most pious person has to officiate that nikah or that marriage ceremony, it is no guarantee that you're going to be happy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness. He is the owner of happiness. So similarly, when it comes to salatul janazah, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that prayer of his was definitely powerful, different from everybody else's. What an honor to have the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam lead the salah. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu says, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going forth now to lead the salah, I blocked him, I stopped him, I paused for a moment. I told him, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you want to lead the janazah of this hypocrite. He used to say this and this and this, and he used to do this and this and this. Have you forgotten what he's done and what he said, and you want to honor him by leading the salah? Look at Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. He's worried. He's saying, we have this hypocrite who harassed us and has hassled us throughout our lives, and today you're going to honor him the final moments. The Prophet ﷺ was sent as mercy to entire creation. You know that. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have not sent you, O Muhammad, peace be upon him, except as a point and a means of mercy to all the worlds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand this mercy. So he said, O Umar, Allah has given me an option to seek forgiveness for him or not to seek forgiveness for him. So I will choose to seek forgiveness and I leave it in the hands of Allah. Because verses were revealed earlier, استغفر لهم أو لا تستغفر لهم. Seek forgiveness for them or do not seek forgiveness for them. إن تستغفر لهم سبعين مرة فلن يغفر الله لهم. Even if you are going to seek forgiveness for them 70 times, Allah will not forgive them. Allah is telling Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you know what he tells Umar? Listen to the mercy. This is why earlier we spoke about Tha'labah ibn Hatib al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, and we said it's not possible for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have rejected a man who came crying, a man who came with remorse and regret. Because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells Umar ibn al-Khattab in this hadith, which is absolutely authentic, regarding Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, that if I knew that Allah would forgive him had I made istighfar for him more than 70 times, I would have done it more than 70. Did you hear this? Amazing. What mercy. What kind of a heart. Look at us. We cannot forgive our brothers and sisters and uncles and aunts and in-laws and outlaws. Allah forgive us. Allah forgive us. We don't want to forgive anyone. Here is the man sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is saying, this hypocrite, I'm ready to say astaghfirullah for him. May Allah forgive him. Allah will decide what will happen. But Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu was still dissatisfied. But obviously, he follows the instruction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The janazah was led. And later on, verses were revealed. Guess what verses were revealed? Verse number 84, Surah At-Tawbah. وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا وَلَا تَقُمْ عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ إِنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Allah says, and do not ever lead Salatul Janazah for any one of them, and don't even stand at their graves. They have disbelieved in Allah and His Messenger, and they have died as sinful people who were disbelievers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is made mention of in a hadith of Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu, also authentic, where he says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the list of people who were hypocrites, named one by one, the whole list. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, confided in Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman and told him, oh Hudhayfah, I'm telling you the list of those who are hypocrites. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the list was counted. And it was so amazing that every time one of them died, somehow, conveniently, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not there. So this is why it's reported that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu and some of the Sahaba, they used to check, is the messenger there? If he was there, they knew this man is not a hypocrite. Subhanallah. And if he wasn't there for the janazah, they had their doubts. But more than having their doubts about others, do you know what was their concern? Their concern was, are we from among the hypocrites or not? Look at Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He went to Hudhayfah and, you know, he spoke to him and he wanted to extract the list from the man to say, look, I just need to know these names. Umar radiallahu anhu is a big man. MashaAllah, he's the second of all those who were great from among the Sahaba after Abu Bakr, as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, without a speck of doubt, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. So Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu, he says, I can't give it to you. I am a person who is trustworthy. I was entrusted with a trust by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Impossible for me to give you that list. So they finally settled on something. What was it? He says, okay, at least tell me his my name on the list. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was informed then, your name is not on the list. Subhanallah. He was worried. As powerful a muttaqi he was, conscious of Allah, pious man, sahabi. He was so powerful in his system, his whole style, that every time he said something, it was a powerful statement. Radiallahu anhu. Sometimes the words he said literally came later on in the Quran. We've seen some and we will still see some in this beautiful Reasons of Revelation series. That was the man. And he's worried. Am I a hypocrite? My brothers and sisters, let's learn a lesson. With us, perhaps we are overtaken by hypocrisy in a lot of ways. May Allah forgive us. May Allah strengthen us. May Allah grant us the ability to revisit our hearts. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to cleanse our souls and to cleanse our systems and spirituality and closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He grant it to us. Ameen. So these were some of the verses where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was instructed not to lead Salatul Janazah and not to stand at the graves of those people or make dua for them. Then we have verse number 91 of the same surah, Surah At-Tawbah. The same battle. We're talking of Tabuk. Difficult battle. Narration of Ibn Abi Hatim, reported by Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, who used to be one of the scribes of the Prophet, peace be upon him. He says, I was writing revelation, and suddenly we were instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go out in the war. And verses were revealed saying that we need to go out for this particular battle, the battle of Tabuk. And there was a blind man who came and he said, oh messenger, what about me? I'm blind, I can't see. Am I also to go out, or is there an excuse? So verse number 91 was revealed, excusing those who were disabled. لَيْسَ عَلَى الضُّعَفَاءِ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرْضَى وَلَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يَجِدُونَ مَا يُنْفِقُونَ حَرَجٌ إِذَا نَصَحُوا لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Allah is making an exception. He says there is no blame on those who are weak, nor those who are sickly, ill, disabled, etc. The exception was being made of this particular man. Like we said, it was the reason of revelation of this beautiful verse. If we pause for a moment, I've spoken about it before. When Allah has instructed us to do something, He definitely takes into consideration our ability. Definitely. If you are unable, He will not punish you. If you cannot read Salah standing and now you sat and you read your Salah. Whether you were dizzy because of being in a ship or an aircraft, or whether you were unable because of your health, both of those excuses are valid. It was inability, either yours or the surroundings. But you tried, that's all. So this is Allah's mercy. The same applies to wudu. You don't have water, you can do tayammum. We've actually talked about this. May Allah help us understand His mercy. So merciful, so loving to all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all fulfill His commands, which have really been simplified for us. Yet we still find ourselves so lazy. May Allah protect us from laziness. Ameen. Then we have verse number 99, Hadith Muttafaq Alayh, reported by Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. Now, before we get into this verse, Ka'b ibn Malik al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, he was known as one of the three. One of the three. Now, what is meant by one of the three? There were many people who stayed back when it comes to the battle of Tabuk. The bulk of them were hypocrites, because you had three main categories. One, those who had an excuse, like we mentioned moments ago, those who were ill or sickly and so on. Two, those who were hypocrites, like we spoke about a few moments ago. And three, those who made a mistake. They wanted to go, but laziness overtook them. And they said, okay, we'll go just now. We'll do it. We'll go. And before they knew it, the army was gone. And before they knew it, it was too late. So from among them, there were three who were really, really remorseful. They regretted what they did. And one of them was Murarah ibn al-Rabi'. The other one was Ka'b ibn Malik. And the third one was Hilal ibn Umayyah radiyallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah be pleased with all of them. The way I remember it is Mim, Kaf, and that Ha, it makes Mecca. So Mim, Kaf, Ha. So Murarah ibn al-Rabi', Ka'b ibn Malik, and Hilal ibn Umayyah, Mecca. If you remember it, you remember the three names. So it's amazing how these people, they have their stories, which we will be speaking about tomorrow. I'm going to start inshallah tomorrow with exactly the details of what happened. It's very interesting, and how Allah forgave them as a result, and what caused their absence from the battle of Tabuk. But Ka'b ibn Malik says, there were hypocrites who remained behind, and I have never remained behind from any battle except Badr and Tabuk. And he says, the hypocrites were exposed even before the messenger came back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verse number 99 of Surah At-Tawbah while the messenger, peace be upon him, was coming back from Tabuk. And Allah says, يَعْتَذِرُونَ إِلَيْكُمْ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ. When you go back to them, Allah is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when you go back to them, to Medina, they will rush to you with big, big excuses. So he already knew people are going to come to me with excuses. قُلْ لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكُمْ. Tell them, do not present your excuses. We are never going to believe you. قَدْ نَبَّأَنَا اللَّهُ مِنْ أَخْبَارِكُمْ. Allah has already informed us regarding all your news. Everything Allah told me, that this is what will happen, and this is what is people are going to come, don't accept their excuses. So Allah says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَحْلِفُونَ لَكُمْ لِتَرْضَوْا عَنْهُمْ فَإِن تَرْضَوْا عَنْهُمْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرْضَى عَنِ الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. They will come to you swearing an oath for you in order that you become happy with them. They will say the name of Allah, wallahi, we did this, wallahi, we have this excuse. We promise by Allah, this was the excuse. Allah says, if you are going to accept that excuse, you need to know Allah will never ever be happy with accepting such excuses. It's not acceptable in the eyes of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. I want to pause there for a moment. Brothers and sisters, we are guilty, wallahi, we are guilty of doing what? Promising what we don't deliver, number one. Number two is finding excuses where we are guilty rather than apologizing and making amends. That is also another issue that we face in our own midst. Number three, we take the name of Allah when we are lying sometimes. Like I said the other day, a person says, wallahi, but my brother, I didn't ask you to say wallahi. You should be such that people believe you because you haven't lied. And the more people say wallahi, and the more emphasis they lay on the term wallahi, perhaps they have something to hide. Wallahi, it's a reality. It's a reality. Why? My brothers and sisters, can we not be truthful people? Similarly, this tongue is an amana from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The tongue is entrusted to us. Wallahi, there are people who cannot speak. There are people who cannot pronounce words correctly. And amazingly, we who have this ability to talk, what do we use the tongue for? The tongue is going to bear witness for you or against you on the day of judgment. Would you like it to bear witness that I was used to remember you, O Allah? I was used in order to repeat your praise, O Allah. I was used in order to read your words, O Allah. That's what we would like, wouldn't we? So let's use the tongue. We talk, we speak, we gossip, we slander, we backbite. How much of it have we used in the right direction? If we were to create a scale and to work out how much we use our tongues, wallahi, my brothers and sisters, we would cry to see how much we waste it and how much in actual fact we use it correctly or to our benefit. My brothers and sisters, it's important for us to protect our tongues from abuse. Bad words, vulgar words, they are written down. They will come and glare us in the face on the day of judgment. You were swearing, you were shouting, screaming. Recently, I had a young boy who I knew, who I saw lots of bad words online by this young chap. And I happened to tell him, you know what, don't use this language. He says, I didn't utter anything, I'm only typing. Look at the answers you're getting. I'm only typing. It's even worse. If you uttered it, perhaps one or two people might have heard it. You typed it, it's there forever. Thousands of people will retweet it perhaps. And then what will happen? It's you. You're receiving and achieving such a great sin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. My brothers and sisters, these are the beautiful words of the Quran. Like I said, the lesson we learned, these people were promising, using their tongues to make excuses. These were invalid. Let us always use our tongues to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, do you realize that we have already completed half of the Quran recitation in Salatul Taraweeh? Already almost half of Ramadan is over. Already we are heading towards the end of this beautiful month. If your heart has not been moved and has not changed and come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't let the second half go by without that happening. Before you know it, Ramadan will go. You might not see the end of it. I may not see the end of it either. But perhaps Allah might grant us the acceptance to see the end. Let's see the end with forgiveness. May Allah forgive us. Allahumma innaka afuwun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Oh Allah, you love to forgive. Oh Allah, you are most forgiving. You love to forgive. So forgive us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahi bihamdih. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.